Last evening we talked about the historical background. Tonight I want to discuss the theology and beliefs of Islam. Again, let me mention what I mentioned last evening. I am primarily addressing Sunni Islam. I am not addressing Shiite Islam. Sunni Islam represents 85 to almost 90% of the world's Muslims, especially those in Indonesia. There are Shiites, and they have some, they would agree with much of what I will present, but they would have their own peculiar take on things. And so I want to say that right up front. And of course, Sunni Muslims, there are all sorts of different kinds of Sunni Muslims. You have Salafi Muslims, which are, I guess the way that I would identify Salafi is somewhat similar to what a charismatic would be in Christianity. And so you can be Sunni. And did I say Salafi? I'm sorry, I didn't mean that, I meant Sufi. Sufi is sort of like charismatic. Salafi is very conservative, almost fundamentalistic. Sufi is sort of charismatic, so you can have a Sunni who's a Sufi and a Sunni who's not a Sufi. And if you're writing that fast, just spell everything out the way it sounds and you'll be fairly close to what you need. So we're talking about primarily Sunni Islam, and the five pillars of Islam are on the screen right now. The first is the Shahada. The Shahada is the confession of faith. And by the way, I want to apologize to my brother from the Voice of the Martyrs over there, who's just now sitting down. He's still standing. I should have worn my bow tie tonight. Then you and I could have taken pictures together. And I am trying to start a new reform fashion trend with bow ties. And so far, it's just not catching on. I'm not really sure why. But I love bow ties. And I have a couple of them in my bag. And I didn't wear one, so I apologize. We would have looked great today. You're all sitting there going, no way. Are you serious? Yes, I am absolutely serious. In fact, you know, some of the debates out there, you'll see that I debated Imam Shamsi Ali wearing a bow tie. I really did, and they seemed to like it. Anyways, the Shahada is the statement of faith by which you become a Muslim. And the English understanding of it is there is only one true God, Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. But you do not become a Muslim by saying that. You have to say the Shahada in Arabic. La ilaha illallah wa Muhammadan, you hear Muhammad there? Wa Muhammadan Rasul. Messenger Allah, wa Muhammadan Rasulullah. Muhammad is the messenger of God. We're going to hear that again in just a moment because we're going to see some folks becoming Muslims. Salat is the prayers, the five daily prayers. I'm going to have a little video on that. Psalm is fasting in the month of Ramadan. Ramadan is the Islamic calendar is based upon a lunar year and a lunar calendar. And so their months are shorter and the year is shorter. And so Ramadan moves forward 11 to 12 days each year in our calendar. And it is a 28 or 29 day month, depending on when the new moon is visible from certain places on earth. And during that time, Muslims do not eat food or drink water during the day. So from the time you can hold up a white thread and a black thread and distinguish between the two of them in the morning till you can no longer do so in the evening, you are not to eat or drink. Now, can you imagine what it's like when Ramadan occurs in July, which it will be soon in places like Saudi Arabia, where you cannot partake of water all day long? It is quite the task. Though studies have shown in Islamic countries that Muslims consume more calories during Ramadan than any other year, any other month of the year, which is interesting because you stay up all night and eat. Then you have zakat, the giving of alms, which is 2.5% of anything you possess for over a year. That's a complex thing we won't really be going into. And Hajj is a pilgrimage, which I will also have a little video on here in just a moment. I want to start off by making you uncomfortable. If you are a Christian, what I'm going to show you generally does make you uncomfortable. This is the equivalent of an Islamic altar call. Now, we've all seen altar calls in many churches. And I know I've been a member of churches where I think the most repetitions of verses from Just As I Am was about 16 or so. But you all know what I'm talking about. And this took place, I would say, about 5-6 years ago in Sydney, Australia. In fact, I had the opportunity of lecturing at Moore College in Sydney last week. And when I had done so 2 years ago, I had a couple students in the class that had actually been at this event. I chose this particular individual because he speaks very clearly. Very often when you have an Islamic apologist, they have a very thick accent. It can be difficult for some people, specifically my wife, to understand the thick accents. Every time I show her, hey honey, listen to what Ahmed Didat said, and she starts listening to it for about 3 seconds and goes, I can't understand a word he's saying. This guy is from Brooklyn, so he's very nice and easy to understand. His name is Khalid Yasin. And this is the end of about a 3-day seminar, which was primarily an anti-Christian seminar. It had grossly misrepresented the Christian faith, contained numerous factual errors of history, so on and so forth. But this is in a Western country, and this is an opportunity for people to come forward and to say the Shahada, become Muslims. I would like you to notice both the similarities and differences as you watch this particular video.
Can you stand for me quickly? Just stand for me. Come right here, please. I want to make this transition or this transaction, because this is what it is. These are human beings that's making a transaction with God. They're not making a transaction for us. They're making a transaction with God and a transition in their lives. So I want to make this easy for them. We have a gift for them, and we're going to give them this gift. Now the gift that we're giving to them is something that will help them on their way. One, it's a copy of the Quran with the transliteration of the meanings. Secondly, it's a short, easy to read, authentic biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. Thirdly, it is a set of 7 books. It is a set of 7 books that have in it lessons for new Muslims. Now, your acceptance of Islam is your acceptance of God, not your acceptance of me, or not your acceptance of these people, nor your acceptance of the political dynamics in the world, because it has nothing to do with that. It's just your acceptance of God. And this gift is to help you make that transition. I want you to say with me the simple words. And these words are nothing more than what I have explained. There's no trick, no curve, and we don't have a pool in the back for you to dip in. But let's say the words. Let's just go over the words called the Shahada. The bearing of witness. And I'll tell you what it is. Essentially, it is the saying of that there's none to be worshipped except Almighty God, and that Muhammad is the messenger of God. Saying that word and then adding to it, I testify or I declare or I announce that there's none to be worshipped except Almighty God, and that I testify or I declare or I announce that Muhammad is the messenger of God, brings you or into the transition of Islam. From that point, it's your sincerity, it's your acts of worship, it is your commitment that will make the difference. Now, whatever you owe God of something you did that only you know and God knows, after tonight, your board is clear. Because God is the forgiver of those that come back to Him. But whatever you owe somebody, money, rent, a loan, you still owe that. Is that fair? Okay, please, just say after me the words, La, La, Ilaha, Illallah, Muhammad, Rasulullah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amin.
That's how you become a Muslim. How many of you had seen someone become a Muslim before? Yeah, almost none of us. Now, what are the things that were similar? Well, you had the encouragement of the crowd. You had the chanting of Allahu Akbar, which is similar to Hallelujah. It's Allah praised in the highest. The applause. You had the coming forward and lining up, you know, similar to someone coming down here. You had the giving of gifts and books. We would call that discipleship. I mean, normally you would give people Bibles and maybe some books for new Christians and similar things like that. I would imagine that they were directed to the mosques that had been involved in bringing Khalid Yasin in and there in the Sydney area. But there are also some real differences. For example, how many of you made your profession of faith in Christ in either Koine Greek or Biblical Hebrew? Anyone say, Jesus Kurios, Jesus is Lord, to be saved? No. I've never had anyone put their hands up. It could happen, you know. But to say the Shahada, you have to say it in Arabic. Now, those folks, he could have been saying anything. He could have been ordering a cheeseburger or something, and they wouldn't have known the difference because they don't speak Arabic. But they have to say it in Arabic. And did you notice the men? Even Khalid Yasin himself. He's dressed like someone would have been dressed, somewhere around the beginning of the 7th century in Arabia. And what I didn't show you is at the end, he goes down the line and he shakes the hands of every man, but none of the women. Because he can't touch a woman. And the women aren't supposed to touch him. And so you have this, some of the most important differences are seen right there. Because you see, to say your statement of faith, to even say your entrance into Islam in Arabic, to do it in a language that you may not even know, and the prayers, when you say the prayers, they have to be done in Arabic. You may not know what you're saying. But you have to say it in Arabic. You can't say it in English. You don't do your prayers in English. Indicates that you see, remember last night I mentioned to you Sharia. It involves the bringing of an entire culture and political system into every other culture and political system. And that's what's causing so much of the strife in the world today. Christianity doesn't do that. Oh yes, Christianity brings all sorts of concepts that may completely overthrow a governmental system. But you see, that's because it changes hearts and minds and attitudes. But you see, Christianity is not a political system, and that's why there are Christians in communist nations, and there are Christians in socialist nations, and there are Christians in democratic nations, and there are Chinese Christians, and there are African Christians, and Brazilian Christians, and Australian Christians, and because Christianity transcends geographical, political boundaries, thanks to Acts chapter 15. And that's one of the major differences between Christianity and Islam at that point. There's much more we could say about that, but time fails us. Now, let me very briefly show you this is an Islamic video, as was the last one, concerning prayer. In Indonesia, you don't ask someone if they are a Muslim, you simply ask, do you do the prayers? And if you've ever lived in an Islamic country, a really practicing Islamic country, you know that five times a day, the society comes to a screeching halt. And in fact, in some nations in Europe today, sometimes traffic now comes to a screeching halt, especially in France, because the Muslims are coming out of their mosques and putting their prayer rugs out in the streets and stopping traffic to do their prayers. And that is causing strife in that particular nation. But here's a discussion of the prayers. And this would be one of those things you'd give to a new Muslim, explaining how to do, this is just a very small portion. This is after they've talked about how to do wadu, which is the cleansing that you have to go through before you do these prayers. There's all sorts of complex rules. In fact, you may have heard of the controversies going on in universities, airports, and things like that, where there is pressure to make available places for Muslims to do their ritual cleansing before doing their prayers. But after that, here's a brief discussion of just a portion of the concept of prayer.
Facing towards the Qibla, the Kaaba in Mecca.
There's the Kaaba.
Is a necessary precondition of performance of prayer.
There it is.
Muslims believe that the Kaaba is the first house built to glorify and worship the one God by the prophet Abraham. Muslims from all over the world, whether they are in the east or west, north or south, turn their faces toward the Kaaba at the prayer time. If a person is in a place such as a desert,
that's Phoenix,
jungle, a strange town, or a place where he is unable to find out the direction from others, then he is allowed to use his own judgment and offers his prayers facing in any direction that he thinks the Qibla could be. Nowadays, a compass is available, which gives the direction of the Qibla from anywhere in the world. The person now makes the niyyah, or intention in his mind, more specific, relative to whatever prayer he is ready to perform. Again, the niyyah does not have to be expressed aloud. Now that we have gone through the preliminaries for offering the prayer or salat, we are about to commence the act by declaring the niyyah. Straits the required number of rakats or units in each prayer.
The Fajr prayer is the first prayer in the morning.
Fajr is from dawn to sunrise. The number of rakats are 2 sunnah, 2 fard.
Allahu Akbar.
And notice the woman is behind the man.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim.
Notice the hands.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
Surah Al-Fatiha, the first surah of the Quran.
Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki yawmiddin.
Watch the translation. Owner of the day of judgment.
Iyyaka na'budu.
Thee alone we worship. Thee alone we ask for help.
Ihdina as-sirata.
Show us the straight path. Mustaqim. The path of those whom thou hast favored, not the path of those who earn thy anger, nor of those who go astray. Keep those two words in mind, anger and astray.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Now notice what language it's in.
إنا أعطيناك الكوثر. فصلي لربك
hands have
وانحر.
To be right hand over left.
إن شانئك هو الأبتر. الله أكبر.
The women are always behind the men. When I took my last Golden Gate class to observe prayers at the mosque at Arizona State University, the women were actually behind a curtain, and the men were up front facing what's called the Qibla. You heard her mention the Qibla, which is the direction toward Mecca. And that's a fascinating area. I can't go into that right now. But you notice in Surah Al-Fatiha, lead us in the straight path, the path of those who've earned thy mercy, thy grace, not the path of those who've earned thy anger and those who've gone astray. What you need to understand is that for the vast majority of Muslims, and this is the early commentary, when Muhammad was asked who that was, those who earn thy anger are the Jews, and those who go astray are the Christians. And so if that's the understanding, and that's certainly what Muhammad said, there's no question about that, in the early tafsir literature, the early hadith recordings of this, that means every day in every prayer a Muslim prays not to be you. So you need to understand some of the barriers that exist between you and a Muslim as you seek to present the gospel to them. And that's one of them, as they've grown up praying not to be led astray like you have been led astray. I think that's an important thing to mention. The last of the five pillars is Hajj, and I do have a brief little clip, obviously, from the television station on Hajj that, again, has some good shots of, even higher quality shots, of the goings-on in Mecca, the Grand Mosque, and the Kaaba there in Mecca. And by the way, the Kaaba is not, the building itself is not sacred to Muslims. It's the black stone in one corner of the building that's sacred to Muslims. The building has been torn down, rebuilt numerous times during history, probably within the past 30 years it was redone. It's the black stone that they're actually bowing toward.
Islamic pilgrimage to Mecca is compulsory for all Muslims in good health and with sufficient funds to make the journey. The Hajj is the foremost of all Muslim rituals, even if less than 10% of all Muslims ever manage to complete it. The Hajj's importance lies in its allowing the believer to approach the center of the world, as well as the place where the Quran's divine revelations began and continued for about 12 years. The performer of Hajj does not only reenact Muhammad's ritual, he or she also recalls acts of important people in Muslim history. The rituals performed around the Kaaba reenacts when Prophet Abraham and Ishmael transformed the Kaaba into the sacred place of worship and peace. In spite of some physical hardships, pilgrims who complete the Hajj consider it one of the greatest spiritual experiences of their lives. Many Muslims regard the Hajj as one of the great achievements of civilization because it brings together people from around the world and focuses them upon a single goal. A believer is required to make the pilgrimage at least once in his or her lifetime.
All right, now I'm looking at the clock going, oh goodness, we must move more quickly. The six articles of belief of Sunni Islam is a belief in Allah, belief in all the prophets and messengers. There have been many prophets and messengers. As I mentioned, many of the biblical prophets are specifically identified as prophets and messengers from Allah. But from the Islamic perspective, what binds all of them together is one message. They all said, La ilaha illallah. They all said, there is no God but Allah. That's what makes one a true messenger of God. They believe in angels, and they believe in the jinn. I mentioned the jinn to you last evening, from which we get the concept of genies. Belief in the books, plural, sent by God, which includes the Torah and the Injil. And belief in the Day of Judgment, including the concept of hellfire, and belief in destiny or qadr, that God, Muslims believe that on the day of your birth, God writes upon your forehead the day of your death. And that in fact, at a certain point in gestation, an angel comes and writes what kind of life you're going to have, when you're going to die, whether you're going to be a believer or not. The problem is, this becomes a form of fatalism within Islamic concepts, because Allah, unlike the God of the Bible, is utterly transcendent and is not specifically involved in the events of mankind in the sense of he himself becoming involved with mankind. He always is involved only by intermediaries and things like that. Now, I'm going to have to skip at least one, probably two of these, because I'm not going to have time to get through these, but I did want to give you at least one example of the Muslim mindset. You must understand, one of the dangers in doing a brief summary of anyone's belief is that you're going to get a surface-level understanding. There are many times people, I'll go through Mormon beliefs, for example, and say, how could anyone believe something like that? I know so many intelligent Mormons. Well, that's the danger in compiling everything and putting it in one place and seeing it in that way. There's a wide variety of Muslims in the world too. This first clip is of a question asked of me in 1999, the first debate I did with a Muslim. I had not started studying Islam as yet. I was simply defending the deity of Christ. I was debating a man by the name of Hamza Abdul Malik on Long Island. And as you can see, the man asking me the question is not from the United States. And I'll be interested in sort of watching your reactions to his objection to the deity of Christ. See if you even understand it, and then we'll discuss it. There we go.
Yes, my question to the doctor. I heard you repeating many times he's saying he's a creator about Jesus. Mm-hmm. Peace and blessing be upon him, because we Muslim believe in Jesus, the mighty prophet of God. I heard you many times he's saying he's the creator of everything and all things. So I want you to explain to me if it's possible, if he's a creator of everything, when Jesus, peace and blessing be upon him, was he walking by the fig tree with his companion, and he wants to eat some fig, and they told him, Master, the fig is not in season. So if he was God, how he don't know if he create the tree, how he know, how he does, he doesn't know if what's in season or what not in season, if he create everything.
Okay.
And if the fig was not in season and he's God, first of all, we don't accept God to be hungry. He wants to eat, but you Christian, you said God choose to do so, so that's your faith. But I'm saying, even if you was God and fig is not in season, why he couldn't order the tree to bring fig?
Okay,
isn't
thank
that
you.
God the one create everything?
Okay, thank you. To Dr. White?
He did so because the fig tree represented the people of Israel, and he made the application the people of Israel look like they have fruit, but they do not. It was a clear application that he made. Secondly, he did eat food because the word became flesh. He became hungry. He became tired. Because as the New Testament, as it was written, clearly indicates, Jesus Christ was the God-man. The eternal Logos became flesh and dwelt among us. He was a true man. He ate food. He became tired. He slept. He grew. Etc., etc. Christians have always believed that. Why? Because we believe all the New Testament teaches.
Now, it's a little bit difficult for us to understand the argument. Hold off a little while, and when we get into the Quran, I'll show you that he is giving a Quranic argument. But I looked out, and some of you are going, what, Jesus isn't God because he didn't know when figs were in season? You really think Jesus didn't know when figs were in season? I mean, seriously, but he's quite serious. And if you didn't know what the backgrounds were, how would you respond to him? How would you respond to someone saying, well, how can Jesus be God if he has to eat and if he doesn't know when figs are in season? That's something to consider. I'm going to have to skip the next one just on time. It's a clip from Sheikh Jalal al-Barru. I would like to show you one last clip, and that is to give you the range. There you have what we call the fig tree argument. From 1999. Now I want to jump forward about 7 years to a debate that I had at Biola University with Shabir Ali. And this is from our cross-examination, and I think you'll notice a little bit of a difference in the mindset of Shabir Ali.
Is there any way that you can give to us this evening to explain to us how we can determine what is still inspired in the New Testament and what is not?
Well, I believe that Muslims have a simple answer to this in saying that whatever is in the Quran, that would be a judge of whatever is there in the Bible. So whatever if the Bible agrees with the Quran, that obviously is inspired. What is contradictory is obviously not from God. And that which is neutral, neither in agreement nor in disagreement, may be treated with some bit of silence. Usually the classical scholars have recommended silence. But I believe that Muslims who are quite familiar with the Gospels and familiar with the development of the text over time can make some judgments, though these judgments will be tentative.
So everything about the cross, resurrection, atonement, deity of Christ, Jesus is the Son of God, the Holy Spirit is a divine person, not an angel, Gabriel, all of that stuff is uninspired and a corruption of the original intention of the New Testament in light of the Quran.
A Muslim would say that the Quranic revelation is here now as the pristine word of God. That teaches us that there is only one God, that Jesus is his Messiah, but nevertheless a servant and messenger of the one true God. And so anything that is contrary to that, something that teaches, for example, that human responsibility as described in the Quran is to be somehow evaded, that would be contrary and would be thought to be a later development. Now, of course, that could be studied from another angle. One can look at the history and development of Christian teaching over time. One can look at the Gospels even without Islamic presuppositions. And it seems to me that many biblical scholars are coming to conclusions which are very close to the main conclusions which Muslims insist on, that Jesus was an apocalyptic prophet like the prophets of the Old Testament. He preached the belief in God, similar to the belief in that was known from the Jewish prophets, since he himself was Jewish. He lived in a Jewish Jewish milieu.
You mean people like the Jesus Seminar, John Dominic Cross and Marcus Vorg.
It doesn't have to be them. The scholars are so numerous, it'll be hard for us to list them and to name them now.
So is there any New Testament book that Mark, for example, which you've referred to many times, Mark clearly identifies Jesus as the Son of God, puts words in his mouth that you would never be able to accept as a Muslim. Isn't that correct?
Well, it is clear that even Mark must have suffered from a similar sort of phenomenon that we described in the case of Matthew. And John Bowden has made specifically that point in his book, Jesus, the Unanswered Questions. If we look at Mark chapter 1, verse 1, which in many Bibles begin the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, it is noted in the NIV, for example, that the title, the Son of God, in this particular verse, is not found in some of the most ancient and reliable manuscripts. So I'm not saying that the Gospel according to Mark does not present Jesus as the Son of God, but we have to be aware of scribal changes that have affected the Gospel according to Mark in places as well. And in fact, we are working with the Gospel according to Mark only as it has come down to us. Knowing the history of scribal changes, we would not be out of our grounds to wonder if in fact we do really have the original Markan Gospel.
Would you admit that you do not have any hard manuscript evidence from the first or second centuries that gives to us a New Testament that looks like a Muslim would expect it to look like?
We do not have such a document.
So there you go. Obviously a very different perspective. You may have noticed Shabir's not using any notes. He quoted from Mark 1:1 and the textual variant noted in the NIV from the top of his head. When he did his 20-minute opening statement, he did not use any notes either. And so there is a wide range. Now, my experience is most of the Muslims you'll encounter are much more like the first man than they are like Shabir Ali. But if you're prepared to accurately talk to Shabir Ali, then you'll be prepared to talk to everybody else. It's best not to aim for this side and then run into this guy over here, if you know what I mean. So that's just to help you to keep that in mind. Now, we're going to have to really pick up the pace here, but I don't want to do it too quickly. We've got a lot to cover, but I think it's very important. There are no creedal statements in the Quran. The closest we can get is Surah 112, Surah Al-Ikhlas. Surah Al-Ikhlas is one of the shortest surahs, since it's right toward the end. Remember I mentioned to you last night, they get smaller and smaller, and so 112 out of 114 is pretty small. You have the entirety of Surah 112 on the screen right now. Say he is Allah, the one and only, Allah, the eternal absolute. He begetteth not, nor is he begotten, and there is none like unto him. Now the first, second, and fourth ayahs we can pretty much agree with in the sense of absolute monotheism. There's all sorts of texts in the book of Isaiah, Jeremiah, that say the same things as you have here. But the third ayah says, Lem yelid wa lem yulid. He begetteth not, nor is he begotten. And the classical interpretation of this text has directly related it to the Christian concept of Jesus as the Son of God. It is a denial that God begets or is begotten. And so there is it's important for us to understand that Muhammad taught that to quote this one surah was as good as quoting a third of the Quran. This is a very, very important surah. Most Muslims will know this surah. And yet one quarter of it is dedicated to a denial of what you and I believe. Muslims take offense at what you and I believe about God having a son, probably because of what the Quran thinks that means. What the Quran thinks that means and what we believe by it are two different things, as we'll see in just a few moments. But Muslims are offended by the concept of God having a son. And they believe that's exactly what we are doing when we speak of Jesus Christ. In fact, they believe that is the sin that I mentioned to you last night of shirk, here in Surah 31:13. O my son, do not associate anything with Allah. Indeed, association with him is great injustice. The term association is shirk. In fact, in secular Arabic, shirk just means like a corporation, to associate together. Yet in religious things, it is to associate anyone or anything with Allah. Muslims believe that we are associating a creature, Jesus, with Allah, and hence in our worship are engaging in shirk. Now there are, as I mentioned in one of the audience questions last night, some Muslims who do not believe that we're committing shirk. In fact, interestingly enough, Shabir Ali does not believe that we are committing shirk. At least that is how he has explained it to me most recently. And I think there are some others that take that perspective. I'm not sure how they come to that in light of certain Quranic texts, but that's one of the things I'll be discussing with Shabir before we have a debate next March in Canada. In Surah 6:1, we read, "All praise is due to Allah, who created the heavens and the earth and made the darkness and the light. Then those who disbelieve equate others with their Lord." That's considered to be an act of kafir, disbelief, to equate someone with Allah, which again is normally associated with our beliefs as well. In Surah 4, 47 through 48, we read, "O you who were given the scripture," that's the Alal Kitab, the people of the book, "believe in what we have sent down to Muhammad, confirming that which is with you," that is the Quran, "before we obliterate faces and turn them toward their backs or curse them as we curse the Sabbath breakers. And ever is the decree of Allah accomplished. Indeed, Allah does not forgive association with him," that's shirk, "but he forgives what is less than that for whom he wills. And he who associates others with Allah," shirk, "has certainly fabricated a tremendous sin." In the same surah, "O people of the scriptures," Alal Kitab, "do not commit excess in your religion," ta'alu, that's what they believe we have done. The Muslims believe that the original apostles did not teach what we teach today, and we have gone in excess of what the original revelation actually was. "Do not commit excess in your religion or say about Allah except the truth. The Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary, was but a messenger of Allah, and his word which he directed to Mary, and a soul created a command from him. So believe in Allah and his messengers, and do not say three." Now, as I mentioned last evening, Yusuf Ali's translation says Trinity. That's not the word Trinity. There's a different word for Trinity. "Do not say three, desist, it is better for you. Indeed, Allah is but one God." Now, I just stopped immediately and say, just on the basis of normal language, normal human communication, if I say to you, "Do not say three, there is only one football team in New Orleans," what was I talking about when I said three? Do not say three, there's only one football team in New Orleans. What am I saying? Exactly. I'm not saying there are three football teams. Don't say there are three. There's only one in New Orleans, right? I mean, you're doing better than we did. We don't even have one. I'm from Phoenix. Think about that for just a moment and you'll figure it all out. So if I say, "Do not say three, there is only one God," what does that mean? It means the author of the Quran thinks we believe in three gods, that we are tritheists, that we are associating Allah, Jesus, and who? Well, you'd think the Holy Spirit, but in the Quran, the Holy Spirit is the angel Jibril. You might be able to figure out who the third one is if we just sort of keep reading. Anyways, "Indeed, Allah is but one God. Exalted is he above having a son. To him belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth, and sufficient is Allah's disposer of affairs. Never would the Messiah disdain to be a servant of Allah, nor would the angels near to him. And whoever disdains his worship and is arrogant, he will gather them to himself altogether." Then the next surah, Surah 5, 72 through 77, we read, "They have certainly disbelieved," they have committed an act of unbelief, "who say, Allah is the Messiah, the son of Mary. While the Messiah has said, O children of Israel, worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord." Now, if you're turning to the concordance of your Bible to find where Jesus said that, don't bother, you're not going to find it. The Quran puts many words into the mouth of Jesus, and I've always found it very, very ironic that my Muslim friends will question the validity of the Gospels and question the accuracy of John's recording of Jesus' words or Mark's recordings of Jesus' words, as Shabir Ali did in that debate. And yet they'll accept this. There is no evidence that Jesus ever said these words for 600 years after he lived. The only reason that a Muslim believes that Jesus said these words is because Muhammad said he said these words. And yet they'll question sources much closer to Jesus from Jesus' own disciples that also claim to be inspired. I don't find that to be overly consistent, but that's what goes on. It continues. "Indeed, he who associates," shirk, "others with Allah, Allah has forbidden him paradise, and his refuge is the fire. It literally says in Arabic, Allah has made paradise haram to him. We had dinner this afternoon. It was very, very good. But one of the things we had was pork. What is pork? Pork is haram, forbidden. What is the good? Have you all started seeing shops yet here in areas where there's a large number of Muslims? What do you want? Halal. Halal shops all through London today. You'll see halal everywhere. In Europe and places like that, halal, Dearborn, Michigan, if you want to see halal shops, halal meat, because that's what Muslims can eat. So Allah has made paradise haram to those who associate with Allah. His refuge is the fire, and there are not for the wrongdoers any helpers. They have certainly disbelieved. They're kafirs who say Allah is the third of three. Allah is the third of three. And there is no God except one God. So once again, as soon as you have the word three, what's the very next phrase? Only one God. So what clearly is the author thinking? You're saying there's three gods. Of course, the doctrine of the Trinity never says that there are three gods and denies that. Excuse me. And if they do not desist from what they are saying, there will surely afflict the disbelievers among them a painful punishment. So will they not repent to Allah and seek His forgiveness? And Allah is forgiving and merciful. The Messiah, son of Mary, was not but a messenger. He was a mere Rasul. Other messengers have passed on before him. And his mother was a supporter of truth. They both used to eat food. Look how we make clear to them the signs, then look how they are deluded. Ring any bells? Fig tree. Fig tree. There it is. They both used to eat food. But you're probably going, wait a minute. Who's the other one that's supposed to eat food? Mary. Mary? Oh, we don't believe Mary's a god. Are you suggesting that the author of the Quran, Allah, say not three, we've got Allah, we've got Jesus, I already mentioned the Holy Spirit's never mentioned. That's Jibreel. Who's the third? Why mention Mary? Why say Mary had to eat food? Keep that in mind. Look how they are deluded. Say, do you worship besides Allah that which holds for you no power of harm or benefit, while it is Allah who is the hearing or knowing? Say, O people of the Scripture, do not exceed limits in your religion beyond the truth. Do not follow the inclinations of a people who had gone astray before and misled many and have strayed from the soundness of the way. Remember in Surah 1? Do not let us be like those who are in thy anger, the Jews, or those who what? Have gone astray, Christians. There you have it again. Now, is it possible that the Quran could so completely misunderstand the Trinity as to think that Jesus is literally a child in the sense of begotten at a point in time and that's what we mean by Son of God? That they don't understand that we believe that the Son of God has eternally been in that relationship with the Father? It's not that the Father has a wife and had a kid. And is that really possible? Well, Surah 39:4, had Allah wished to take to Himself a son, He could have chosen whom He pleased out of those whom He doth create. But glory be to Him, He is above such things. He is Allah, the One, the Irresistible. And look at Surah 6:101. To Him is due the primal origin of the heavens and the earth. How can He have a son when He hath no consort? And I asked my Arabic tutor about the Arabic term here. And he said, well, today it sort of has a negative connotation to it. It's sort of like a woman on the side. You know, it's like a mistress. How can he have a son when he hath no consort? He created all things and he hath full knowledge of all things. So when it asks about sonship, what's always associated with it? A woman having a child. And that certainly was the concept that you find in the Kaaba and the gods who had daughters and sons and so on, so they had wives. Is that how Muhammad understood the Trinity? Well, let's continue on Surah 5 and see. And beware the day, which is the day of judgment, when Allah will say, O Jesus, son of Mary, Isa bin Maryam, Did you say to the people, take me and my mother as deities besides Allah? He, that is Jesus, will say, exalted you. It was not for me to say that to which I have no right. If I had said it, you would have known it. You know what is within myself, and I do not know what is within yourself. Indeed, it is you who is knower of the unseen. Why ask this question? Why say that at the end of time, Allah is going to ask Jesus, did you tell the people to worship you and your mother as deities in derogation of Allah? Now remember, this is the same surah that keeps saying, do not say three, there is only one God. Do not say three, desist. There will be punishment for you if you keep saying three. But who are the only three this surah mentions? Allah, Jesus, and Mary. That's why I said last night I had a debate in London in February with a Muslim, and I pointed this out and said, that's not what we believe, and even if you don't believe in the Trinity, even if the Trinity was wrong, did Allah know what it was in 632? He sure did. So if he wanted to say it was wrong, he could do so clearly, even if Muhammad didn't understand it, because this is supposed to be the words of Allah, right? And he had to argue that you can't look at what Surah 5, 72 through 77 says and connect that with Surah 5, 116. We really don't know what it means. And I'm the one saying, hey, I'm letting it speak for itself. It says don't say three, and the only time it defines the three is Allah, Jesus, and Mary. There you have it. Now, it is sort of sad to hear these words put in Jesus' mouth, where he says, you know what is within myself, and I do not know what is within yourself. Maybe when you first heard that, you, hopefully the words of Jesus from Matthew chapter 11 came into your mind. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Clearly, Muhammad did not know and had never met the Jesus of the pages of Scripture. He was ignorant of what Jesus taught. Now, time is failing us, and we must go on to this text, because if there's any text that you need to understand this evening, any text you need to write down, take notes on, be prepared to deal with, it's on the screen right now. Yes, everything else I've shown you is important. I mean, it's obviously very important when you're trying to speak to a Muslim to recognize that they think you are calling them to commit shirk. What's the one sin that if you die on it, you'll never be forgiven? Shirk. And so what do they think you're calling them to do? To bow the knee to the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Commit shirk. So yeah, that's a huge, huge barrier in your way. You have to be prepared to deal with that. No question about it. But there's more. There's more. Here you have on the screen the one verse in all of the Quran, in all of the Quran, that denies the crucifixion. Just one. Now, I have here the Sahih International translation. I was trying to be consistent. And this is one place where it's not quite as literal as Yusuf Ali, and I'll mention where that is. But in the Sahih International, it's speaking of the Jews, and it says, and for their saying, indeed, we have killed the Messiah, Jesus, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah. This is allegedly what the Jews were boasting about. And they did not kill him, nor did they crucify him. Now, literally, the Arabic at the next phrase is shubiha lahum. It was made to appear to them. Now, this one has, but another was made to resemble him to them. That is a real expansion of that little Arabic phrase shubiha lahum. And I'll explain why that is in a moment. Indeed, those who differ over it are in doubt about it. They have no knowledge of it except the following of assumption, and they did not kill him for certain. The next verse actually says, rather, Allah raised him, Rafahu, to himself, and ever is Allah exalted in might and wise. Now, the vast majority of the world's Muslims, I can guarantee you all those guys standing in line to ask me questions there in 1999 that you saw, the guy right behind the fig tree questioner spent 7 minutes trying to ask one question, which was Jesus white or black? He finally got around to that after about 7 minutes. But we had some interesting questions in that line, but I can guarantee you all the Muslims in that line would have believed what's called the substitution theory, which is clearly laid out here in this translation. What they believe this text is saying is that someone was crucified, but it wasn't Jesus. Someone was made to look like Jesus while Jesus was taken up by Allah to heaven. And someone was made to look like him, and that's who they crucified on the cross. Part of the reason for this is from the Islamic mindset, God would never, ever allow a special prophet like Jesus to die such a shameful death. Never allow it to happen. That's a stumbling block to them. Prophets are to die in a special way, and if Jesus was a prophet, then there's no way he could be crucified the way Jesus was crucified. It's not possible. And so who do you think the primary candidate is to be made to look like Jesus and crucified on the cross? Who do you think? Judas. Sure, that's a fitting punishment, isn't it? So most Muslims believe Judas was made to look like Jesus and he was crucified on the cross. Now, I received an email, an article from a Muslim back in 2001. Long thing, filled with bold and underlined. It looked like something that like Peter Ruckman would write, but all sorts of different colors and things like that. And it was proving that it was Simon the Cyrene that was crucified on the cross. He was absolutely certain of it. That's called the substitution theory. Now, a lot of Western Muslim scholars shy away from this. When you ask them who is crucified, they'll go, Allahu Alam, God knows, God knows. Why do they shy away from the majority view of Muslims around the world? Well, think about it. If the substitution theory is true, and God made somebody else look like Jesus and had him crucified, then in essence, Allah sort of started Christianity by mistake. I mean, think about it. He not only fooled the Jews, he fooled the Romans, and he fooled all of Jesus' disciples too, and started a whole religion that's resulted in all sorts of shirk. And so there's a lot of Western Muslims that are sort of like, I'm not sure we really want to go there, but you can see in the translation, that's how this translation understands it, that someone was made to look like Jesus. Shabih halahum, what does it mean? Well, you know, for all those other texts, like Surah 112 and Surah 5 and Surah 4, we can go into the Hadith and there's all sorts of places where Muhammad talked about these things. And so you can get some guidance from the Hadith as to how to interpret these things. There's questions about the accuracy of the Hadith. There's no question about that, but that's an issue we can't go into tonight. When you go to the Hadith, what does the Hadith say about Surah 4, 157? Absolutely, positively, nothing. It's never mentioned. No Muslim for over two centuries could remember a single thing that Muhammad ever said about this verse. And if it weren't for these 40 Arabic words, the Quran would speak about the crucifixion, or not the crucifixion, but at least the death of Jesus. Surah 355, Surah 1933 would naturally refer to Jesus' death. But because of this one verse, then they interpret those other ones in a very unnatural way. But this is it. This is all they have. And yet I've done entire debates on whether Jesus was crucified or not. And the Muslims will say, no, he wasn't. Now, Shabir Ali is a little bit odd on this one. There is a group of Muslims called the Ahmadi Muslims. They're considered, Orthodox Muslims view them like we view Jehovah's Witnesses. And it's because they believe that there was a prophet after Muhammad. He lived at the end of the 19th century. And yet, as far as anything else goes, they have pretty much the same beliefs as all of the Muslims. They're pacifists. The Sunni Muslims kill them regularly in Pakistan, unfortunately. In fact, I had a whole bunch of Ahmadi Muslims come to a couple debates that I did in Brooklyn, because they have a mosque in the area. And after one of the debates, they said, are you speaking anywhere else here in New York? And I said, yeah, I'm going to be speaking at a Baptist church on Wednesday night, and I'm going to be presenting a presentation on the reliability of the text of the New Testament. And they said, that's when we have our meeting on Wednesday night. We'll cancel our meeting and come to yours. And so that night, we all start getting together at a Baptist church, and half the people coming to the door are Muslims, Ahmadi Muslims. And they got up and asked some great questions afterwards. But they listened to the whole presentation on the reliability of the text of the New Testament. I got to and of course, I added new stuff just for them and all sorts of stuff. And afterwards, I was talking with the imam of the mosque. And he said, the next time you come to New York, let us know. We'd like you to speak at our mosque. So hopefully later this year, because I haven't been back since that time. So I'd love to see it happen. But the Ahmadi Muslims believe that Jesus was crucified, but that he didn't die. They believe in a swoon theory. And he got out of the grave, and I think he went somewhere to India, as I recall. And Shabir Ali doesn't necessarily know where Jesus went, but he also thinks Jesus was crucified, but he didn't die. So he has an unusual view of that particular issue. But it's all based on Surah 4:157. Now look at the commentary that's provided by Yusuf Ali on this subject. The Orthodox Christian churches make it a cardinal point of their doctrine that his life was taken on the cross, that he died and was buried, and on the third day he rose in the body with his wounds intact and walked about and conversed and ate with his disciples and was afterward taken up bodily to heaven. This is necessary for the theological doctrine of blood sacrifice and vicarious atonement for sins, which is rejected by Islam. The Quranic teaching is that Christ was not crucified nor killed by the Jews, notwithstanding certain apparent circumstances which produced that illusion in the minds of some of his enemies. Well, it didn't just produce the illusion in the minds of some of his enemies, it was all his friends too. But that's Yusuf Ali's commentary at that point. As I mentioned, some Western scholars take a very different view. Muhammad Asad, who has a huge commentary on the Quran, it's about yay big, published by CARE, you've heard the Council on American Islamic Relations. His commentary on this text says, compare Surah 355, where God says to Jesus, verily I shall cause thee to die and shall exalt thee unto me. The verb rafa hu, literally he raised him or elevated him, has always, whenever the act of raf, elevating of a human being, is attributed to God, the meaning of honoring or exalting. Nowhere in the Quran is there any warrant for the popular belief that God has taken up Jesus bodily in his lifetime into heaven. So there you have a different perspective being presented by an Islamic authority. From the Western perspective, but again, that's not going to be the view that you're going to run into very often in the standard Islamic dialogue that you would be having. Now, when I did a debate with Imam Shamsi Ali, I did some radio programs with him beforehand, and I was very interested to hear him telling the next story that I'm going to tell you. This is just the beginning of the story. I'm not going to just go through all of it, but let me tell you a story from the Hadith. According to Muhammad, and again, let me just mention the Hadith. There are a number of collections of Hadith, Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Muslim. This is found in the most reliable sets of the Hadith, and the same story will be told multiple times in different ways with variations. And so I'll tell you the version I'm most familiar with, and you'll find it in a number of different ones. But there was a man who had murdered 99 people. So he had a mass murderer. And he goes to a priest, and he says to the priest, will Allah accept my repentance? And the priest says no, so he kills the priest. So now he's murdered 100 people. And he goes to a scholar, and evidently the scholar is smarter than the priest. And when the man says, will Allah accept my repentance? The scholar says, go to such and such a city, and in that city they will tell you what you must do for your repentance to be accepted by Allah. Okay, so the man begins to go to the city. Now remember, Shamsi Ali told this very same story on a radio program, so I'm not pulling this out of some, you know, this is in some obscure corner of the Hadith. This was a story that he told to illustrate the freedom of Allah's forgiveness and mercy. So as the man is going toward this city, the time of his death comes. Remember, as I said, according to Islamic teaching, the date of one's death is imprinted upon one's forehead, literally before one's birth. And so when a person dies in Islamic theology, two angels come and they fight over your soul. One is from the fire and one is from paradise. And the one from the fire says, he has no good deeds and he's murdered 100 people. But the one from paradise says, but he was going to find out about repentance. And so Allah decrees that if the man fell one cubit closer to the city he was going to than the city he was coming from, he would go to paradise. And then he caused the earth to shrink between where the man was and where he was going, so that when it was measured, he was one cubit closer to where he was going, and therefore the mass murderer went to paradise. So there you go. There is a story told, narrated by, in multiple chains, and what I mean by that is in the hadith. What the Muslims think is so special about the hadith is that there are these chains of narrators. There's a path that you have to be able to follow all the way back to Muhammad. And sometimes the same story will have multiple chains of, it's called an isnad chain. And there's a huge science of hadith, and I've listened to hours of lectures on that. And like I said, if I ever get hit by a truck out there riding my bike listening to all this stuff, when they pick up my iPod, they'll be calling Homeland Security. There's absolutely no two ways about it. Can't believe what this guy was listening to. So if you hear a story like that, you sort of go, well, why would a Muslim ever have concern about whether they get to heaven? Because if a mass murderer can get into heaven because he's one cubit closer to asking about repentance, then a Muslim who does the five daily prayers and a Muslim who gives zakat and fasts during Ramadan and has said the shahada. In fact, there are hadith where Muhammad says, anyone who truly from their heart says, La ilaha illallah wa Muhammadan Rasulallah, if you've said that with real sincerity, none of you will ever face hellfire. Now, he also said that everyone will be in it for a while, but that his intercession will remove them from hellfire at some point. In fact, some people are in there so long that they become known as the people of the fire because they're blackened by they've been in the fire so long, but they're still going to go to paradise. So remember, the books of hadith aren't this big. Sahih al-Bukhari is 8 volumes, and Sahih al-Muslim is like 9 volumes. And then you've got Jami at-Tirmidhi and Sunan Abu Dawood, and you've got all this stuff, and there's a lot of stuff in there, and to be perfectly honest with you, I don't find it to be overly consistent. And so you look at that and you go, someone who's done all that stuff, how could they be worried about hell? And yet, those same hadith sources will record companions of Muhammad, and they are considered to be the greatest Muslims who ever lived were the companions of Muhammad. Even the Quran says they were the greatest generation. And some of the companions wept as they thought of their death because they did not have assurance that they would ever escape the hellfire. And just for the ladies, did you notice in the clip that I played with Khalid Yasin, most of the people down front who had come down in the Islamic altar call, what were they? They are women. They are women. So just for you ladies, here's Muhammad. I was shown the hellfire and that the majority of its dwellers are women. That's such a strong hadith. It's found in both. There's a special technical term. There's a special technical term for a hadith that appears both in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih al-Muslim, which means it is very, very strong. This is one of them. I mean, this one can't be questioned. Now, if you're wondering, ladies, the women did ask Muhammad, why? Why is that? His answer was, well, it should be obvious. I mean, oh, you should be able to, in fact, do I even need to give you the answer? Because it's so obvious. Huh? Well, no. The answer was, Well, he said, isn't it clear? Your testimony in law, court of law, is not worth that of a man, which has to do with your integrity. And secondly, there's a certain period of time during the month when you can't do the prayers. So clearly that's you're deficient in matters of religion. Now, if you're thinking, and I just have to feel some of these women were thinking this, but they didn't give voice to it, was those are both your rules. You're the one that says my testimony isn't worth that of a man in a law court. And you're the one that said I can't do the prayers during that monthly time. So why are we in hellfire because of that? But no one actually said anything about that. It was just, okay, you're the prophet, and there you go. Remember this picture? Remember that? We've gone full circle. This is where we started. Those of you who weren't here last night, this is the video from an attack on Glasgow Airport in 2007. And last night we started with this and asked the question, why did the two men in the Jeep try to kill all sorts of people they did not know? And I mentioned the two men in the Jeep were Muslims, and they were not down and outers. They were not recent arrivees from Yemen or Saudi Arabia. They were National Health Service doctors, MDs, men with a bright future. And yet they purposefully got into a vehicle filled with gasoline that they thought when they pushed a button was going to explode in a massive fireball that would then fly into the airport and consume everybody standing there at the counters checking in for their flights, counters that I have stood at a number of times myself because I've done a lot of ministry in Glasgow and have flown through there. I flew through there. I preached in Glasgow. I've had two kilts made in Glasgow. Two formal kilts. Yes, indeed, I am Scottish. And in fact, I took them back to be taken in because I had them made when I was that big and now I'm this big, and they were tents, so they were really very, very useful to me. And so I had them taken in back in February. So I stood there at those very counters, and what those men wanted anyone staying there to go up in a ball of flame and to die a horrible death, because that's not a good way to die, to be engulfed by, in essence, napalm. The only people who died were the two men, and they died slowly. They died of their burns over a lengthy period of time. But this comes back to full circle. But now we have the theology. I don't know why the Lord has laid Islam on my heart so heavily since 2005. Because I'll be perfectly honest with you, my ministry would be a whole lot better off if I wasn't talking about this. But there are more popular topics. If I was always going after Christopher Hitchens or somebody like that, and I was going to debate Christopher last year, but then he got his diagnosis of cancer. And yeah, I still deal with atheism, but look, I'm talking about Islam a lot these days, and it's not good for the ministry in the sense that it's hard to get even conservative, reformed, Bible-believing people really excited about this. Because if we're really honest, we have a pretty deep prejudice. Most of them are foreigners. There's fear. We'd much rather argue with an Arminian, you know. Seriously, you know. Get out my theological sword and run you through with some John Owen. Whoo, you know. When it comes to Muslims and Islam, that's all out there. And yeah, maybe up in Dearborn, but you know. Part of what I've done is I've taken a lot of time listening to Muslims talking to other Muslims. I mentioned a man last night, Sheikh Yasser Qadhi, and I listened to him lecturing to other Muslims. And he's constantly having to warn other Muslims. When Eddie starts coming forward, I check my watch, but he's constantly having to warn other Muslims about what's called bid'ah. We'd call that heresy or innovation. And one of the things that he's constantly warning people about is the elevation of Muhammad. And as I listen, well, what do? Well, they go to Muhammad's grave and they leave things for Muhammad. And I mentioned to you last night, they believe that if you open Muhammad's grave, he'd look exactly like the day he died, because prophets' bodies do not corrupt in the grave. And they pray to Muhammad. And they seek Muhammad's intercession. And there is a doctrine of Muhammad's intercession, even in the hadith. And as I listen to this, and as I listen to Sheikh Yasser Qadhi trying to emphasize the need to be pure in your worship of Allah, and I listen to what Muslims are doing, I can't tell you how many times in all these different places I've been. Normally I'm listening to stuff while I'm riding my bike. Some of you know I'm a cyclist. I did 9,000 miles last year. You get a lot of time to listen to this stuff when you ride 9,000 miles on a bike. And it struck me over and over again, and sometimes it's caused tears in my eyes. These people believe in a transcendent creator God. They believe that he's holy. They believe he's given his law. They believe that we have sinned against him. They believe in hellfire. They believe in a day of judgment. But because of one man's teachings, who didn't know the New Testament, thought the New Testament supported what he was saying, but he was wrong, they don't believe in the Son of God. They don't believe that God actually would enter into his own creation. That's why I had to debate a very precious young man at the University of New South Wales just a week ago Monday night on this very issue. Can God become a man? They don't have a mediator. And they've been denied the only one God's ever given us. They have the holiness, they have the punishment, but the one way that God has bridged that gap between his absolute holiness and the sinfulness of man, the one way God has done it has been denied to them. And so by nature, they start trying to fill the gap because they sense their own unworthiness. Here you have two doctors. And you know why they're in that fireball? Because the one way that the Quran says you can be certain when you die of going to paradise is if you die in jihad. And that's why when the front end of that Jeep hit those doors, they looked at each other and they pressed the button. It wasn't because of some overwhelming hatred of the people in there. They didn't even know who they are. But they did have an overwhelming sense of their own unworthiness before Allah. And this would be the way to make them worthy in his sight. And in the news just recently, within the past 2 weeks, the man on the flight to Detroit, coming in over Detroit, what does he do? He presses the button. He does whatever it was he needed to do. Thankfully, it didn't work. And instead, he's sitting there, and according to the testimony, did you read some of the testimony from the court? He's sitting there in the seat next to the window, and a guy literally has to look at him and say, "Your pants are on fire." But he doesn't move because he's hoping it's going to actually explode, blow out the side of the plane, and destroy the plane as it's coming into Detroit. Why? Because he became convinced by the preaching of men like Osama bin Laden and Anwar al-Awlaki that to die in jihad is to glorify the name of Allah and to guarantee that you're a mujahid, a martyr for the cause, and you will enter into the presence of Allah because you have done so. Because he's pleased with anyone who will promote, who will bring fear into the hearts of the kafirs. And they've been convinced this is the way to do it. Now, are there people like Yasser Qadhi and other people who say, no, you don't understand. That's not how you do it. You're not to take innocent lives. But you see, the other Muslims say, excuse me, but in our theology, everyone is born a Muslim. Did you know that? You were born a Muslim. You were born believing there is one true God, and it was your parents who perverted you into Christianity, Judaism, or something else. And what is the law of Islam for someone who is a Muslim and then leaves Islam? It's death. There's no question about that. Muhammad said, anyone who changes his religion from Islam to something else, it's death. And in most Islamic countries to this day, that remains the law on the books as well as the law of Sharia. Well, if you are born a Muslim and you're not a Muslim anymore, are you innocent? No, you're an apostate. You're an apostate. So they reason, I'm not killing any innocent people. If I blow up this plane, there are no innocent people on this plane. Because if you're not a Muslim, you once were when you were born, and now you're not. Now other Muslims say, oh, no. But you see, the problem is you're all drawing from these sources that are self-contradictory. And so the young man, I think, was that you last night, young man, asked the question. There's the real problem. The real problem is that the debate within Islam is based upon sources that I don't think can ever finally finish the debate. Now, I bid my moderate Muslims who don't want to kill me on the airplane Godspeed in their argument. But I just don't think that they can ever win it completely. Now, we need to understand that not every Muslim wants to kill me. But we need to understand why the ones who do, do. And it is small consolation for me, to be perfectly honest with you, to even listen to Sheikh Yasser Qadhi. Because when he says, if there is ever a caliph, there is no caliphate right now. Caliphate is, would be a worldwide Islamic government, and a caliph would be the leader of that worldwide Islamic government. He says, if there's a caliph that can declare jihad, then all of the property and life of the kafirs is forfeit. And then the moderate Muslim would be able to say, time for me to kill you. That concerns me. That concerns me. There's no question about that. So now you understand the theology behind it. Is there much more to the theology? Oh, we could talk about, there's fascinating things. Just one real quickly, and we'll start taking questions. But one thing just is really interesting to me, because I'm always looking for, and this is something Eddie's always looking for, bridges, means of communication, points of contact, is that according to the Quran, at one point, Allah, in the life of Adam, he rubbed his back, and out from Adam came everyone who would ever be born in the human race and stood in this great plain. I mean, it has to be a great plain if everyone's going to sit there, stand there. And he took a covenant from them, a mithaq. And he said, am I not your Lord? And all of us said, yes, you, Allah, are our Lord. And so the Muslim believes we all made a covenant that Allah was our Lord. And while we don't remember that specific experience, the recollection of it, or the mark of it upon our souls, is called the fitrah. And the fitrah has direct parallels to what we believe about the Imago Dei, the image of God, in Romans chapter 1, that says we are suppressing the knowledge of God. The Muslim believes that all he has to do is do dawah. Dawah is to call people. In fact, it's interesting, in Islam, evangelism and apologetics are the same thing. The same thing. So, dawah, a Taoist, is a person who's giving the call to Islam. And he's defending it, but he's also calling people to come to it. And they believe, most of the really conservative Muslims believe, arguing with atheists on philosophical grounds is a waste of time, because they already know that Allah exists. They have the fitrah. You appeal to the fitrah, and that's how you get someone to come to Islam. Okay? There's all sorts of fascinating things there. Let me just say, and if you want to ask some questions, Eddie has the microphone down front, and we'll get in line and we'll take some questions. But I would just challenge you to pray for opportunities to bear witness of who Jesus is to the Muslims.
I too am an evangelist Christian, and I was witnessing to a girl at the airport. She was telling me about that she, you know, Muslim. I was talking about Jesus. But from what I understand, and maybe I'm wrong, but does the Quran not say anything about love? So I tried to reach her from that aspect that, you know, Jesus, Yeshua loves her, and, you know.
The Quran does speak of Allah being loving. It's not a major attribute, but it is always, Allah's love is always limited to those who love Allah. So the idea of Allah showing love toward his enemies so that he would enter into human flesh and provide for their salvation and then actually reach down and change their hearts, completely outside of the range of what Allah would do. from their perspective. So especially demonstrating the love of Jesus, while at the same time, there is one thing I would say. They need to hear about the love of God, but they need to realize likewise that it is a sovereign love. Because when you present, and I'm very concerned about this, when I talk to Muslims, they have heard a lot of evangelicals present the love of God in a very squishy, sentimental, warm, fuzzy, koala bear puppies at Christmas way. And almost like God is my girlfriend stuff, you know? And when I present them the sovereign love of God, a Jesus, you know the picture of Jesus with the little lamb in his arms, you know, that one? They need the Jesus of the book of Revelation, who rules the nations with a rod of iron. They respect that Jesus, because now when you talk about his love, it's the love of a powerful Lord. And you are calling them to bow the knee before the Lordship of Jesus Christ in repentance. I had the opportunity in London of presenting that message to a room full of Muslims during a debate, and it was silent. They listened to that. They need to have a biblically balanced presentation of who Jesus is. And unfortunately, very often, they get the idea that Christians are presenting a very sentimental, squishy Jesus who does not command them to bow the knee before him. And the gospel, yes, there's pleading, there's exhortation, but folks, first and foremost, it's a command. God commands men everywhere to repent, and we need to understand that.
Okay, my second question, I appreciate that, and I always tell people the first chapter of Revelation, Jesus holds the keys to hell and death, and that's pretty powerful right there.
Right.
He conquered death. Okay, the second...
That would be an excellent point to present, by the way. Mm-hmm. It really would be.
The second question is the inconsistencies. What do you say, because Muhammad started off with there's no compulsion, very peaceful, what in Mecca? And then in Medina he ends pretty violent. What, you know, how do you, in other words, if Muhammad's words or whatever, the thing that I don't understand either too, he was illiterate. So, you know, he couldn't read or write. How can, you know... Well, anyway, in my mind, God wouldn't speak to someone. Well, whatever. He guesses God could do whatever he wants to. But I mean, if the words being, say, like dictated to Muhammad, or Muhammad wouldn't dictate and the person would write because Muhammad couldn't read or write, how do you explain inconsistencies? You know, that he's this way because God shouldn't be flip-flopping is what I'm saying.
Well, that is going to be answered by different Muslims in different ways. Again, one of the issues is, you know, the moderate Muslim in the Western nation emphasizes the no compulsion religion. The historic Islamic perspective has a doctrine called abrogation, where the earlier sections of the Quran are abrogated by later sections. There's one of the real obvious examples of this. The Quran at one point says don't come to prayers drunk, and then later on says don't drink any alcohol. Well, obviously, when the first revelation came down, it was okay to drink alcohol, just not in excess, and then the second revelation comes down and says nix may that, get rid of all of it. And so the concept of abrogation is called in, where the later abrogates the earlier. Well, there are a lot of people, you know, Al-Awlaki and Osama bin Laden and others would say, well, the texts on jihad abrogate the texts on freedom of religion. But in the Western world, Muslims will say, no, that's not actually the case. You need to take it all as a whole. And so it's really a fight within their own circles at that point as to which one is to be taken over the other. The problem is, you then look at the hadith, and one side takes their hadith, and the other side takes their hadith, and you end up with these types of debates. So it depends on the Muslim you're talking to as to how they're going to try to figure out those alleged contradictions. They, of course, think we have all sorts of contradictions as well, and you have to deal with them sort of in the same way.
All right, very good. Real quick, we're going to be taking up a love offering again this evening. If you were here last night, this isn't an attempt to double dip into your pockets. Do as you see fit.
I sort of forgot to plug in my computer. It survived, thankfully, but it's not going to much longer. Even though it's not on the screen anymore, I'm not sure why. Thank you. I'll bring up the Quran here in a second. Go ahead.
Two questions. Number one, what do you believe is the main motive for people becoming Muslim, particularly non-Arabic people? I think you said last night most Muslims are not Arabic and most are in Indonesia. Is it because of the strict monotheism? Is that, would you think that's the main motive?
In a free country like we saw in Sydney, that is, would seem to me to be the primary motivation. I remember very clearly a debate that I attended in Norfolk, and Nabil Qureshi, a former Ahmadi Muslim, was the Christian debater, and the man, the Muslim who was debating him, was an African American who was a former, if I recall, Baptist, before he became a Muslim. And his reason for converting was, Islam gave me guidance from God that Christianity never gave me. And in fact, it's fascinating to me that he said the last time he was in a Christian church, he had been introduced to Islam, and he comes into this Christian church, and the band is playing, and the minister of the church gets up and grabs a saxophone and digs into a real good riff, and he stood there going, this can't be the worship of God, and he never came back. So from his perspective, it was that rules and regulations for every aspect of life, revelation from God. Now, worldwide, to be perfectly honest with you, the reason that you have growth in Islam is primarily political. Let's face it, if Islam becomes the predominant religion in a nation, most folks just go along with it because if you don't, you know, look at what being a Pakistani Christian gets you. You know, you're pretty much limited in what you can do in life and educationally and everything else. So it's just easy to go with the flow. And so once Islam becomes the predominant religion, I think most people join it just simply because that's the easiest thing to do.
Right. Yeah. Secondly, what would you say if someone made an argument that the God of Islam, I believe there are some surahs that command persecution upon particularly Jews and Christians,
Surah 929,
infidels, yeah. in general. What would you say if someone said, what's the difference between that God commanding that and God commanding the people of Israel to conquest the land of Canaan?
Yeah, good question. Very, very often in the debates that take place between Islam and between Muslim apologists and Christian apologists on the issue of violence and things like that, that is the very question that has to be dealt with. I'm disappointed with some of my Christian friends who basically say, well, that was just all Old Testament, and as if that's an answer. It's part of the answer to recognize the context, and that you had a specific situation where God is working with a particular people, and he is bringing the Messiah into the world, and it was a theocracy, and his law was to be lived by these people, and they were to be a testimony to the world, and through them was to come the Messiah, and all the rest of that stuff, and it had a particular fulfillment in a particular place, and then draw the proper contrast between that and the command of the church to go into all the world, not to establish a particular theocratic form of Israeli government, but to preach the gospel. And so, unfortunately, some of my friends end up throwing the law of God under the bus in the way that they handle this by just saying, well, we're not under law, we're under grace, and just make a, you know, just in essence, decanonize 39 books of the Old Testament. But the fundamental difference in that situation is that Islam has gone backwards to a situation that no longer exists. We can agree that there is a point in history where God commanded his people to be instruments of judgment upon very wicked nations. And that's exactly how Israel functioned. Of course, they likewise then became the object of God's discipline and judgment when they themselves began doing the very same things that the nations they dispossessed were doing. And that these were, according to the New Testament, these were written for our instruction to this very day. But what Islam has done, again, is you have that revelation, you have that time frame, you have the fulfillment of what God was doing in the prophecies of Jesus Christ. You now have the church going out, and the only means of persuasion the church has is the proclamation of the gospel and the power of the Holy Spirit changing people's hearts. We are not given the power of the sword to enforce some kind of religious law upon somebody else. Well, what has Islam done? It looks at that original revelation, here's the fulfillment, hangs a U-turn and goes back to what? If it's already been fulfilled, if God has in the past spoken unto us by the prophets, now in these last days he's spoken unto us by his son. Well, they've basically hung a U-turn, rejected God's self-revelation of himself, and they've gone back to something that really creates a perversion. Because while there was a purpose at one point in time, now to have that same mindset and attitude and behavior and action, look what it's resulting in. The horrors of what you can see. I mean, I've seen some videos, I'm not sure I should have watched them, of just recently, within the past 6 months, the Taliban capturing police recruits in Afghanistan and executing them. And it's just brutal. You know, shooting people in the head and then shooting them over and over again, and the, you know, the video goes on for 10-15 minutes. It's just horrible. And you see that, and that's what happens when, again, you follow this line, and then here's this great revelation. No, I'm going back. It becomes perverted.
I have a question about is there God perfect? Because in basic Christianity 101, God's perfect, we're not. Thus Christ took the punishment because we can never pay it back. Mm-hmm. However, maybe I'm thinking about Islam extremists where they believe, you know, they have the power to do this and they'll go to paradise, but you have an imperfect man doing this. Is Allah perfect, or how do they justify imperfect men trying to satisfy the law of this God?
Allah is perfect, but that doesn't mean that from our perspective Allah would be complete. We would see some deficiencies in the character of Allah because of his utter transcendence and his inability to, well, for example, to enter into human flesh. I would argue that that is an imperfection on Allah's part. But where they would find a problem with your question was that you are assuming that they are trying to do something to fulfill God's law. They don't, that's what's missing. They don't think they have to fulfill God's law. They don't feel that God's law has to be somehow vindicated. A law can simply forgive a sin, and his law can simply remain broken. There does not have to be atonement. There does not have to be any way in which the law's righteous commands are fulfilled. God's law can be broken, and that's perfectly fine. A law can simply forgive that. There doesn't have to be any restitution. There doesn't have to be any atonement. A law can simply say, that's fine. So there's where the problem is.
And then you said they could earn favor? Did I get that right, or did I misconstrue?
Yeah, but you're hearing it with Christian ears. It wouldn't necessarily translate. Yeah, a lot of Muslims do have the idea that I do my prayers, I've been on Hajj, I give zakat, and there is, it's just a natural human thing to think that I've sort of fulfilled these things for, you know, God's pretty lucky to have me, you know. Unfortunately, you get a lot of that in the Christian church too. So, but there isn't necessarily the same, you know, certainly within sacramental systems, within Roman Catholicism and other, some Protestant groups that have a sacramental system, there's the idea of, you know, condign merit and congruent merit and all the rest of this kind of stuff. And that's not really a part of the Islamic mindset, though.
All right. Thank you. Yeah.
You're welcome. But I sure hope that's a different green shirt than last night. I think it is. It's not as bright as last night.
I wanted to say that, like, if Muslims do believe Jesus did come down from Allah, just like we believe, except we don't believe in the Allah part, and we believe it's God, how could they say that our religion is wrong when they believe in the same person?
Well, they don't believe that Jesus came down from God in the way that we do. They believe that he was a prophet sent like Moses. There was something unique about Jesus. They do believe he was virgin born. They do believe that he was sinless. They do believe he committed, did miracles that Muhammad never did. So they do believe that he was uniquely the Jewish Messiah, but he was not eternal. He did not exist before his birth in Bethlehem. And he is a mere prophet on that level. And as such, he did not come to give his life, and he was not crucified, and he did not rise again the third day. So there are fundamental differences between what we believe about who Jesus is. Again, Muhammad comes up to the point of accepting these things, but then he backs away and he takes his followers with him, and that's why they don't have a mediator and they don't have a gospel.
And this is pretty off topic, but in a debate, have they ever threatened you to death or anything?
Everybody always asks that question. No. That has, the closest thing to anything that's come to that at all was in a debate with Sheikh Jalal Abu Al-Rub. And during one of the rebuttal periods, I was pointing out the inconsistency of the Sheikh to misuse and abuse the Bible the way he was. And I made the comment, I said, if I were to abuse and take the Quran out of context, the way that the Sheikh has been taking the Bible out of context, what would you do? And I was told later by people in the audience that one of the Muslims had rather loudly said, we would kill you. I didn't hear it. I would have certainly commented on it had I done that. But that's the closest that I've come. No, I've not gotten anything like that. I don't get regular death threats from Muslims.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, Eddie is another question. That's another story.
When we're witnessing to people who are not necessarily believers, but they have a concept of Jesus, we use a form of logic that's pretty effective. And I was wondering if it would be effective with Muslims.
Lord, liar, lunatic.
Yes.
Go ahead and explain it. I just knew what you were referring to.
Jesus basically says that he is the Lord, he's the Son of God, and he came directly from God and is God. And he either knows this is true or he doesn't know that it is true, so he's either Lord, liar, or lunatic.
Right.
And he can't just be some nice guy. You know, he can't. I mean, Islam obviously puts him up on some sort of pedestal. It's kind of hard to decipher whether they want to keep him there or not, but people who say he was a real nice guy obviously don't really know what he was saying, because if he was saying the things that he was saying and they weren't true and he knew they weren't true, he really wasn't a nice guy.
Right.
He really wasn't a good prophet.
Right.
Would that be an effective form of...
What it's always going to bring you back to with a Muslim, and this is something that we have to deal with, and I would just highly recommend hitting my YouTube page and seeing my presentation on this, or bugging Eddie to bring me back to do the presentation here or something like that in the future. But all of it comes back to, from their perspective, that the Jesus who said those words is the Jesus of the Bible, and that Bible has been changed. That Bible has been corrupted. The Jesus they read about in the Quran never said those words. He just argues for monotheism and the prophethood of Muhammad. So he just says, worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord. He doesn't make the statements, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, I will give you rest. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Their Jesus doesn't say those things, and they are convinced that Jesus historically did not say those things, and that the record of those things in the Bible is a fabrication. And so it all will come back to, well, he's not Lord Liar Lunatic. The one you're talking about is a creation of a later generation of Christians who have abandoned the actual true faith of Jesus. So it all comes back to the reliability of Scripture.
Saying that we're putting words in his mouth.
Yeah.
I have another one.
Did you pay Eddie for one or two? I didn't see.
I was quick. There are conferences going on. They started out in the Arab world. And
Common
and
word?
The caliphate conferences. The caliphate, you're not familiar with? There are caliphate conferences.
Keep describing them, see if I'm heard of it.
Excuse me?
Keep describing it so I can see if I've heard of it.
Basically, it's leaders in the Islamic world are getting together and they're having conferences about the restoration of the caliphate.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And they've had them in the Arab world, North Africa, and then they started having them in Europe. Now they're having them in North America, Canada, and in the United States. And it appears to be this is an acceleration. And so when you said earlier tonight that there's a caliph and there's a caliphate, if they do join up and there's a caliphate, there will be a caliph, then it's on, huh? I mean.
Well, yeah, there's obviously a huge desire on the part of Muslims in the world to have the Muslim caliphate, to have a world Islamic government. The problem is there's not a single truly Islamic government in the world right now to begin with. The closest you can get to a Sharia law government is the Taliban. And the vast majority of Muslims do not want to live under the Taliban. So you need to understand, like the Saudi royal family and people like that, have a vested interest in keeping any of that from actually happening. So yeah, there's always the theoretical desire to have that kind of thing happen, but there's massive things standing in the way right now of anything like that taking place. And the jihadists don't feel the need to actually have that. They just simply say, look, we're clearly under attack by Zionist armies. As they would identify even our armies, Zionist and Christian invader armies. We don't need a caliph to tell us this. We just need to respond. So, but yeah, there's always been a discussion of the reestablishment of a caliphate, but there's just massive practical things standing in the way of it.
Can I get one more? Can I do one more?
We're running on time here, so.
Yeah, just if you have more than one, just limit to a half of one. just kidding.
Yeah, let's limit it to these. Do I see three there?
Yes.
Okay, these will be the last three.
What's up with this Chrislam movement that I'm hearing about in the United States?
Chrislam, yeah. There are lots of confused people in the world. Remember the poor Episcopalian female priest lady up in, where was it? It was had to be the Northwest, because there's only certain places on the planet where people can get this zany, something in the air. I think it's lack of sunshine, actually, is what it is, vitamin D or something. But she was an Episcopalian priest who decided that she was also a Muslim, but she wanted to remain an Episcopalian priest. And so there are always people who, you know, imagine world peas, you know, and just, you know, I mean, they're sort of the part of the same people that are part of the Occupy Everything movement right now, you know, Occupy the left lane of the road, Occupy New York, whatever. And there are people who just don't believe in objective truth and are willing to say, let's just all mishmash it all together. And so the best way to stop Christians and Muslims to fighting is we all become one, and it's Chrislam. And there's no one serious in Islam or Christianity that thinks that's a possibility, but there are all sorts of people that pretend to be one or the other that are willing to play at that kind of game. But there's nothing serious about it. It's really confused people.
Am I right in asking this question as would Islam be considered a religion of the Antichrist?
Well, of course. I mean, and I don't say that. Everybody goes, ooh, oh. Excuse me, but what's the definition of an Antichrist in 1 John? If you deny that Jesus has come in the flesh, and they certainly do not believe that Jesus came in the flesh in the way that John defined the coming of Jesus in the flesh to be the Messiah, not just for the Jews. They limit Jesus' messiahship just to the Jews. They deny his crucifixion, they deny his burial, they deny his resurrection, they deny he's the Son of God, they deny everything that John would have taught was fundamental to truly believing in Jesus. So how can you get more anti-Christ than that? But then again, so is secular humanism, and there's all sorts of things along those lines. The problem is the term Antichrist has become politically charged with movies and stuff, and people that rip their faces off, and I'm Henry Kissinger, and you know, stuff like that. And it unfortunately has this whole other meaning that the New Testament actually never applies to. Anybody who preaches a false gospel is an Antichrist. Many Antichrists have gone out into the world. Mormonism is an Antichrist religion. Jehovah's Witnesses are an Antichrist religion. Oneness Pentecostalism. I can name lots of them. The Way International. Blah, blah, blah.
Okay, real quick here.
Best
question is about to come up, so listen up. Okay.
Are you from Brooklyn?
Don't the Muslims believe in the first five books, Torah? I mean, the first five books of the Bible?
Yes or no? That's not a yes or no question. They believe in the Torah. But you're assuming that Muhammad would have had a knowledge as to what that was. The reality seems to be that Muhammad viewed the entirety of the Old Testament as Torah, but he just didn't know because he didn't have any direct exposure to it. So,
okay, now I gotcha. Because what do you say with when it says the God of Israel? Hello, the God of Israel. And they called, what, Jews and Christians dogs?
What do you do with God of Israel?
God of Israel in what?
In the Torah. And the whole Torah is God of Israel.
Muhammad didn't ever read the Torah. There is one good story in the history of Al-Qurtubi where Muhammad was sitting on a couch, on a cushion, and the Jews brought in the Torah. And he got up from the cushion and had the Torah put on the cushion, and he said, I believe everything in this book. But the problem is he didn't know what was in the book. So can you press that upon the Muslim? Yes, but again, then you have to establish that the Torah that we possess today was the same Torah that Muhammad would have said, I believe that everything that's in this book, which you can prove, but how would you do that? That's why you need to know about the Dead Sea Scrolls, issues like that.
Okay, I got 10.
No, you don't.
That was for people that know me.
Go ahead.
All right. I mentioned to you last night about the deal with the guy with the Mormons.
Uh-huh.
One thing he done.
Did you find out who it was?
No, but I got somebody that's going to tell me, and I'm going to email it to you.
Me answer the question. That's the problem.
Well, no. What he done was he brought them to their own,
Book of Mormon, Doctrine, Covenants, Program.
Okay, but what he showed them, and I was asking you if this would work with Muslims, the test of a true prophet, that in every part of the in the Book of Mormon, where there was prophecies made, and there was never a fulfillment of a prophecy, which would fail the test of a true prophet, are there things in the Quran that Muhammad prophesied or these people prophesied that wasn't fulfilled and show them that that's a false prophet?
Well, you can use Deuteronomy 13 and 18, the test of a false prophet, in two ways with Joseph Smith. You can demonstrate false prophecies of Joseph Smith. Section 114 of the Doctrine and Covenants specifically contains a false prophecy concerning the man by the name of David W. Patton, where Joseph Smith said that he was going to go on a mission in company with others, even 12, including himself. Patton died that following fall. He didn't live to the next spring when he was supposed to go on the mission. The other 11 men didn't die. So you can demonstrate a specific historical false prophecy on the part of Section 114 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Documentation is in my book, The Letters to a Mormon Elder. But the main way to prove that Joseph Smith was a false prophet was to demonstrate that he taught a completely different God than the God of the Bible, because there's two elements of false prophecy. You give false prophecies of a future event, or you prophesy truly of the future, but you do so in the name of a different God. I think the strongest argument in regards to Joseph Smith is that he said, we have imagined, supposed that God was God from all eternity. I'll refute that idea and take away the veil so that you may see, in the King Follett Funeral Discourse from 1844. So it was the teachings of Joseph Smith and the false God that he demonstrated that we need to focus upon. The problem with finding prophecies of Muhammad is it's next to impossible to really nail him on any future prophecies along those lines. He made a vague, there's a vague statement that the Romans would win a victory against the Persians sometime over the next 9 years. Woo-hoo. You know, that's like saying the Cardinals might win a football game this season. You know, I'm not sure I'd want to go there, but, you know, they may play the Raiders, so, you know, it could happen. But, sorry, good grief. Didn't you see how many picks that guy threw recently? But anyways, so you might have something like that. But again, the strongest way of demonstrating the false prophethood of Muhammad is to use his own words in Surah 5, where he draws the line of prophethood from Moses, Old Testament, Jesus, New Testament, to himself, and demonstrate that he does not stand in that line, that he contradicts the fundamental fulfillment of prophecy and teachings of those previous books. And so I think that would be the best way to go along those lines. Okay?
All right. We want to thank everyone for their zeal. And we could certainly, like we said, spend about a week on the same topic. Cool. Let's give Dr. White a hand tonight.